introduce Dr. Robin Davidson-Arnott. He's a coastal geomorphologist from the University of Guelph. I've had his CV and was going to read it, but unfortunately that would expend all of our time here today that we've allotted for Mr. Arnott, or Dr. Arnott, sorry. Robin was on the consulting team that did the update for the technical portion of the shoreline management plan, along with Judy Sullivan and Karen Wyanicki. And I think you were primarily responsible for the recession rate analysis in that component of it, and certainly provided some input with regards to the recommendations and so forth. So Robin is going to provide presentations, which some of which have been seen at the steering committee previously, but we thought this was important for the board to see, on cohesive bluffs, some talk about climate change, and I think you're going to touch a little bit on shore protection as well. With regards to the recording, the intent with the recording is to upload it and make it publicly available. We feel that this information that Robin is going to provide today is going to be of great interest to the shoreline residents as we start to move forward. So that's why we felt that recording it today was important. So without any further ado.
Thanks, Jeff. And please, I I'm semi-retired now, and I never did do a lot of the doctor bit, so please, my name is Robin, please just call me Robin. That makes life a lot simpler. My purpose here is just to say, primarily to focus on the elements that I've done in this report, which were really to talk about the processes that and the management of the hazards associated with those processes. And I also was responsible for, as Jeff said, a background paper on climate change impacts, and I'll put some of that up because, as time goes on, I think that's becomes quite important. And we also did work on the recession rates, and I'll be meeting up with Tracy afterwards to see if we can sort that out completely. It's still an ongoing process. Okay, I'm just going to begin with an introduction to the team that put this together, and also some of the considerations that we needed to look at in dealing with the update. What was it that had happened between 2000, when the last shoreline management plan was done, and 2017, that required an update? And then I'm going to talk about managing the hazards of flooding, the dynamic beach, and the cohesive bluff. These are the three sort of areas of processes of shoreline types that the province recognizes in their policy. And I'll say a little bit about each of them, and perhaps I'll certainly stop at the end of each one in case there are questions that come out of that. And then I'll do a very shortened bit on climate change impacts, and then we end up with shore protection. Okay, so the project team, there were three principal people. Karen Wyanicki, who is from Planning Solutions, she's a planner, and if you look at her CV on the web, it's really, really impressive. She works with she has a master's in planning from Queen's. She's worked with conservation authorities, municipalities, the Ministry of Municipal Affairs. She's a facilitator. And so she was the person who did both the sort of public relations and the planning end of things. Judy Sullivan is a civil engineer from Queen's University, with training also in coastal engineering under Bill Campus, who was a sort of world-renowned coastal engineer at Queen's. She worked with the Toronto Region Conservation Authority, and then she was seconded full-time to work with Ministry of Natural Resources, developing the shoreline management policy. This is back in the 90s. And I worked with, that's where I first met her. So she's done that, and she's also now a private consultant working both with conservation authorities, MNR, private cottage owners, and so on. So she's got a wide experience in that. And then there's me. I'm a little different because I was a full-time faculty member in geography. My research area is in coastal processes. I have particular expertise in both sandy beach and dune systems,
and in the erosion of cohesive bluffs. I did a lot of work in the Great Lakes from the late 70s through to 2000, measuring cohesive coast erosion, both on land but particularly underwater. And I've done work, gosh, as long as I can remember, on sandy beach and dune systems, so that's where the dynamic beach part comes in. I'm retired there, but so still just wrapping up the last of my research. And then we had Adam Bonnycastle, who was our GIS person, and we had Ryan Mulligan, who's a coastal engineer at Queen's. There, mostly, if there was a lot of modeling required, there wasn't, and so we didn't use him very much. And Billy Singh from TerraProbe. TerraProbe has been in the geotechnical business for, I don't know, 50 years anyway, and Billy Singh has worked on a number of CAs with the Cohesive Bluff, so he did quite a bit of the work on what's happening in terms of the bluffs themselves. So we wanted to produce a consultant's report that would be used to update the ABCA Shoreline Management Plan from 2000. And the terms of reference included a number of other things, such as the climate change, public engagement, and producing. One thing that happened after we got the contract was that there was no good 1973 recession data, or sorry, shoreline from which we could calculate recession data. Our role was basically to update the information in the shoreline management plan and also to update it on the basis of how has current understanding of the processes changed since 2000, and also the current legislative framework. So our role was to produce that report, and we did that with the understanding and so on of the conservation that the actual implementation of the report is done by so we make the recommendations, ABCA and the board makes the decisions. We were not in the process of making decisions. Other CAs have done it a little differently and put more responsibility on the consultants to do the decision making, but that wasn't the case here. There have been a number of important changes in the policy since 2000. And particularly the new provincial policy statement from 2014. And of course, the other thing that's happening is that the shoreline, and particularly the shoreline property ownership, is changing. Judy and Karen are the principal people who know about the details of the policies and the planning framework. In the report that we've done, these policy and planning things are detailed in particular in chapters 1 and 2 of the report. Unless somebody has a burning question, I'll go on, because while I know the context, I don't know the details of that, and there are probably a few people in the staff who knew way more about it than I do. Okay, so based on the changes in particular to the policy, the provincial policy, and to the various sections of wetlands and planning, one of the recommendations we made within our report was that the operating philosophy for the ABCA should be one: no new hazards should be created. The operation is designed to ensure that we don't create new hazards and that we don't exacerbate or aggravate existing hazards. And finally, and this is something that the provincial policy now is catching up on, no adverse environmental impacts occur. So whatever changes you make to the shoreline management plan, these principles should be incorporated in that. And actually, they're not. I was talking to Jeff about this. Those principles are already in place and have been in place for many years when you look at how you manage the floodplain, the river systems, both in terms of the hazard and in terms of the environment. And what the changes to the provincial policy are doing is to bring the shoreline into that same context. So we're going to, we want to do to the shoreline what we do to the floodplains right now. All right, so the three sets of hazards that we address. The first is managing the hazard of flooding. And along the coast, most of this has to do then with the lake level itself. And the lake level obviously has its, these long-term fluctuations in it that are close to 2 meters on Lake Huron. And in addition to the level, the water level in Lake Huron, as that fluctuates seasonally and over decades, we have to take into account the fact that when there is a storm with onshore winds, there's a setup of the water level due to the wind and to the waves breaking on the shore. That setup can raise the water level here by 40 or 50 centimeters in a good storm. So to get the sort of 100-year, and I think I'll go on to that now, to get this 100-year flood level, that's a combination of the long-term fluctuations, seasonal fluctuations in the lake, the mean lake level or the still lake level. And then on top of that, we have to look at what happens during the storms. And that gives us our flooding. The final bit that goes into that is that when these happen, when we've got storm conditions, we've got waves. And the waves run up on the shore, they go over top some structures and so on. And so there's an additional landward component to it. So we can measure where the still water level, the setup comes on the beach, and then we add another 15 meters to that to allow for those waves. Because it's no good saying, well, my house was flooded, but the water level that you measure is below it. Those waves are what are flooding my cottage. New development is directed away from the flooding hazard. There is some in the area, that there are a few existing cottages at the toe of the bluff or on the dynamic beach. They may be exposed to flooding at high lake levels. So here's a couple of examples. We've got here at the base of the bluffs a few cottages that are in an area which can be susceptible to flooding, especially if we've got a coincidence of high lake levels and a big storm. So there are a few places like that along the shoreline where that's an issue. And there are a few other places like this where flooding can occur. This is, I think, Mud Creek, if I'm not mistaken. And so you've got a juxtaposition of river and lake and the potential for some flooding in this area. It's not a big issue in ABCA. And I think the everything around that is pretty well under control. So before I go on then, any questions about the flooding part of it?
Thank you. Robin, there was a graph two back,
yeah,
or a slide that showed a top graph and a bottom graph.
Right, yeah.
The top graph was lake levels. Was that at Godrich?
Yes.
The lower one says Godrich.
Yes, the top one is actually Godrich. Yeah, it's just me doing it. Yeah, and we'll come back to the bottom graph a little later because I want to talk about it in terms of climate change.
Thank you.
Okay, so we come now to the dynamic beach, which is something that it's not intuitive, but the whole concept behind dynamic beach is that on sandy beaches, and we have lots of them here all through the Pinery and so on, during periods of low wave, low water levels, sand is blown from the beach and it's trapped by the pioneer dune species here, marram grass being the primary one, but as you go further back, you've got cottonwood trees and so on. And so over time, the dune builds up. And that dune acts as a kind of natural dike or wall, if you like, to protect anything that's behind it. But it's a very dynamic environment because we need that vegetation there to trap the sand, otherwise it just blows inland. And the second thing is that, of course, when we have high lake levels and a big storm event, this is what happens. We erode the base of the dune. And so if you put a cottage in there, it's in that zone that gets removed. And it's just if you don't build it on a sand foundation, it doesn't last very long. So the whole purpose of the dynamic beach thing is to get move buildings behind the limit to which storm events will erode that dune, and just allow the dune system to build during low lake levels and then to supply sand back to the beach during the high lake levels. When we were doing this on the initial policy development, we actually tested it in a number of places, because while we had models that could predict the elevation for flooding, we didn't have models that would predict how far inland the wave action would take place on a sandy beach. And so what we did was very pragmatic. We went to several different places and said, okay, can we measure the furthest extent of storm wave action on the sandy beach during those periods of high lake level in 85 and 72 in particular? And we did that down here just at Oakwood, just north of Grand Bend. So here's the beach here. This scarp that you can see back there is the limit that the storm waves during 1972, high lake level, and 1985 got to. And when we measured that, it was, I don't know, 28 meters from the present level. So we did that in several other places, and we said the simplest way of doing this is to say the dynamic beach allowance must be the flood elevation plus a 30-meter setback. It seems to work beautifully. I can even take a little bit of credit for it myself. But, and it's nice that it's down here. Okay, so that then brings us to the flood standard here, which is 100-year plus 15 meters, and then the dynamic beach allowance, which is 30 meters. We suggest to people, if there's a well-developed foredune, that it's probably better to keep your cottages behind that foredune rather than perched on the crest, even if the crest is just slightly landward of the border. So in ABCA, again, most of it works pretty well. The new developments are set back beyond, and here's one, you know, we've got a nice, well-vegetated with marram grass sand dune here, and you can see the relatively new development behind it. This is not quite as nice looking, but here's, I think this is in close to Grand Bend, if I'm not mistaken. And all the development is behind that. This is where I think this is 2014, and there's just a little bit of scarping of the dune. So we've got a well-developed sand dune area and ridge here that's protecting this area from behind. So it's working fine. I don't think we have any issues there. Part of what's happening now is that environmental considerations. And for that dynamic beach to function well, we've got to maintain the vegetation. Otherwise, you end up with something like we see at Long Point right now, where we've got people who have bring in bulldozers and get rid of the vegetation. And then every winter, the plywood goes up to stop the sand inundating their cottages and so on. And that sand goes inland. It's lost from the beach. These days, in fact, if you dig it up, they've got to put it in a dump inland. So what we try to do in this is to make sure that the sand dunes remain intact. And you can see that works here, but there are a few people where that consideration doesn't come. And so sand is coming off the beach, being blown inland here, and ultimately that's lost from here. In the long run, if that continues to happen, the shoreline is going to go back. And so in a place that should be stable, we end up with something that's erosional. And that's why it's so important to keep the vegetation in place. I think I've got one more that, yes. So it's also a matter, and this is, I'm sure Jeff has problems with this, where, you know, there are a couple of people here put structures as part of, beyond their house. These are not dwellings, but they put them onto the dynamic beach, and then that begins to reduce the area in which the sand can accumulate, and it eventually would produce the same impact as too much trampling. Okay, so end of round two. Any questions on the dynamic beach? Yeah.
and it might come under the climate change portion. 30 meters that we arrived at isn't taking into consideration lake level fluctuations and
the sort of size of the storms.
So with a bigger change in weather pattern and less ice coverage and continuing wave action in the winter when we used to have protection there, or more storm events, where does that enter the model?
You know, for the dynamic beach, if it's well constructed, it will make some change. But I think one of the controls is that Lake Huron is a fixed size, so that in general, we don't expect any major change in the maximum size of waves that can be generated. Maybe a little if we get slightly stronger winds. But so unless there is an actual major long-term increase in the lake level, the 30 meters is fine. In fact, the 30 meters is fine anyway, but we would have to adjust the flood standard, and then the 30 meters would go beyond that. So I think I concluded that for the moment, I don't see any major impact on the dynamic beach in the ABCA area. There will also be, there may even be ultimately some change in what the vegetation, the colonizing vegetation is. But again, what controls that mostly is the sand and the adaptation to dry as much as just air temperature. So it isn't a consideration, but I think for the moment we're good with that. All right, cohesive bluffs. These are basically their cliffs, except that in the Great Lakes region, we've tended to distinguish the cliffs that are formed in silt and clay and so on as bluffs, and those in bedrock as cliffs. It's a nice distinction because we've got so much of our shoreline in this. And generally speaking, it's got a high silt and clay content. And in the ABCA, that cohesive material is all glacial till. Essentially, almost all of it is glacial till. It's called the St. Joseph's till. It's deposited at the end of the last glaciation by ice flowing out of the Lake Huron Basin up onto the land. And the material that ice is eroding and then depositing is taken from the original deep basin. So if we go into the basin in Lake Huron now, all our silt and clay from eroding shorelines gets deposited in the deep water. So out there, we've got a big buildup of silt and clay. The glacier comes along, erodes that, deposits it on the shore. The key thing here is that it's very strong because it's been consolidated or over-consolidated by the weight of the ice when it's been deposited. And it's made up of, it's only got about 15% of sand and gravel. So when it erodes from the cliff, from the bluff, 85% of it gets taken off into deep water, doesn't stay on the beach. So you have to erode an awful lot of material to get some sand and gravel that forms your beaches. And Lake Erie, where you might have 60% sand, that all goes on, you've got a much larger proportion that's going into form the sand. And we'll see why that's important in a minute. The other key thing that it seems pretty obvious perhaps, but people don't think about it, is that we've dumped this till here, it's consolidated, that's what gives it the strength. As soon as it's eroded, it's gone. It can't be replaced. That material is gone, you can't replace it. On the sandy beach, you saw that we could erode it during a big storm and then it comes back, the wind bends it back, but we can't restore that. So it's a one-way street with erosion of these cohesive bluffs. So these are the prime components that we think of: the tableland behind, and it's beautiful in all the ABCA area. There's the bluff slope, the toe of the bluff, and the toe is essentially the bottom section and just into the sand. It's where waves actually break at it. Above the toe, we're just dealing with rain and slumping. At the toe, we're dealing with wave action. And then there's the beach and the sort of near shore zone, maybe out to say 6 meters water depth, something like that. Within this, there are different processes that erode the till. So the till is extending from the top of that bluff all the way underwater in most places. But the processes that cause erosion differ between the slope, the toe, and the beach and near shore. So here are the erosion processes. The erosion is initiated whenever we've got a combination of water levels and wave action and so on that bring waves to the toe. And the waves reach the toe. There's erosion just due to the force of the water itself. And it can be breaking directly on it. It can be running up the beach as swash and then coming back. So you've got this sort of thing going on. And in particular, just as in rivers, a lot of the erosion occurs because when the wave runs up the beach, it picks up that sand and gravel, and that sand and gravel abrades the till, and it erodes the thing. So that turns out to be the most important process here. That then, once you start undercutting the cliff, you then make the cliff steeper. Even though the till is strong, if you undercut it, it'll collapse. But if it's steep, we get erosion because of water. So when rain falls on it, it runs down the slope. And you can see this in any road cutting. You've got rills and gullies and so on. And of course, we have the non-water processes, slumping and slides. The third component is that underwater, erosion is also taking place. And as the erosion takes place underwater, that deepens the water in front of the bluff, and it allows waves to continue to reach the bluff as it recedes. The final part of it is that even though it's not a large amount, the silt and clay go offshore, we leave the sand and gravel, and if we erode enough bluff, if it goes back far enough, we've deposited a whole lot of sand and gravel which will protect the bluff, like we have north of Bayfield where we've got the big fillet beach. But at the south end of Lake Huron, big waves from the north and northwest, the sand transport is from north to south and on down towards Pinery, so that the sand doesn't stay in place long enough to build up a thickness that would protect everything. So we talked about the toe erosion, and this is true for all three areas. A key thing is that you could build a 50-story building on the till itself. It's that strong, it's consolidated. But of course, when it gets close to the surface, it starts to weather. You have wetting and drying, and that allows it to expand and contract, and so it loses that strength. We have freezing and thawing in the winter months, and that also does the same thing. So almost all of the erosion takes place in weathered till. It's lost its strength, much as when it dries out, it bakes hard like clays do. But as soon as you put a bit of water on it, it flows. That's a key part of it, so that in this area, the bluffs can be quite steep. But on the surface, that wetting and drying and freezing and thawing is going to reduce its strength. In general, there's more erosion during high lake levels. And in general, the rate of erosion increases with larger waves. So we've got, as I said, three different types of thing. On the slope itself, we can get a little bit of slumping. We'll get rills and gullies taking place. In areas where we've got a well-developed vegetation cover, there's some protection because you've got the raindrop impact is broken up. You've got litter to absorb the water. And you know this from the same thing on the river systems. Shallow slumps, and especially during snow melt, if we have snow, raindrop impact. Occasionally, we can have deep-seated failure. I don't think there's any big ones in ABCA. There's been an incident up around in the Maitland watershed where a large section has, there's been a failure plane and a big slump and slide out of it, but not much happening here. Okay, most of the actual erosion is more frequent during high lake level periods because then you've got the undercutting going on. The last bit is the underwater erosion. It's something that we've known a lot more about since around 1980. It was not something that people took into consideration before, but there's been a lot of work in the Great Lakes, including some of the work that I've done, that have shown that the underwater erosion is very important. And the same thing happens underwater. They till the fluctuations in pressure due to waves going by force water into the upper bit of till, it becomes fluid. And you can see in here, this is just taking a wetsuit glove and running it along the surface. So that most of the erosion takes place, again, in weathered material. It's the waves going backwards and forwards, and of course, the waves are taking sand and gravel that comes out of it and abrading it. So that the it's not a lot. The lower diagram here is from some work I did at near Grimsby. It shows you this is the amount of erosion per year in millimeters. So that's 30 millimeters, 3 centimeters. And you can, this is the depth of water. So it's higher close to shore in shallow water where you get more wave energy. And it decreases further offshore. So it's only 10 millimeters and 6 meters of water depth. That's per year. But the thing about the underwater erosion is it happens all the time. Every time there's wave action, stuff moves back and forth and erosion takes place. It's not dependent on high lake level or you know, a bad winter. It's happening all the time. The final bit I wanted to say here was that there is a fluctuation. As lake levels fluctuate, the erosion underwater varies. And with low lake levels, we think low lake levels are great because there's no water reaching the tour. My house and my shore protection structure are great. But you've now lowered the water level, which brings the main wave activity closer to the bed so that you've got stronger currents moving sand and gravel around. The erosion rate goes up. And of course, we had until 2014, about 15 years of low lake level. Everybody was happy, except that during that time, the underwater erosion was still continuing. So you might end up with 30 centimeters or so more depth of water than you did before that period started, or half a meter in some cases. The rate of erosion is also controlled by the amount of sand that's present. If you've got a modest amount of sand like that, then that's mobilized during a storm. If you've got a meter or more of sand, then what we see happening is that that protects the surface, and so erosion is shut down. It's not ever completely shut down, because if you go to the beach around, you know that at low lake levels, sand starts to move off. We get a sandbar often offshore, and so there's a lot of sand in the bar, but in front of it, you may only have this much sand over the till, and those migrate back and forth. But it does reduce the level, and in many parts of the ABCA, the erosion rate is lower than it might be because we've got buildup of sand and stony gravel over the top. Let me bring the two things together now. What we now know is that the erosion of the bluff toe is controlled by and goes in concert with the underwater erosion. And I'm going to point here. Well, no, I can do it here. If we didn't erode this underwater, but the bluff receded, then we would have a big wide platform. And our waves would lose all their energy on that wide platform. But what happens is that the underwater erosion takes place and that platform gets lowered. And so the big waves can still continue to reach the bluff. So in the long run, it's the rate of underwater erosion that controls how fast the bluff recedes. We see the waves breaking on the toe of the bluff and we see that receding, but it's the underwater part that turns out to be the key. So the erosion hazard for cohesive coasts consists of two parts. One is the stable slope allowance, and this is basically saying if we stopped erosion completely at the toe of the bluff, how far back would the top of the bluff go because of all those, that rilling and gullying and slumping and so on. And it's usually expressed as a slope. In the standard is a 3-to-1 slope. In the ABC area, that bluff is quite quite steep, quite strong, and so it might actually be something closer to 2.5 to 1. But so we want people to be set back far enough from that to allow for the slope to achieve its stable angle and to be vegetated and so on. And then there is a 100-year recession allowance, because we know if there's any recession, any erosion taking place, that the recession will take place. When we were doing the policy back in the 90s, we had to decide, well, what number should we use? Some of the US states were using 50 years. We decided that Ontario would go to 100 years, because we figured that if you build a house and it's got a 100-year lifespan, you don't have to worry about it. At least most people don't anyway. They'll be gone before they, something happens to the house. So that's why the setback is 100 years. We can distinguish here between stable slopes here. Here's one with a lot of sand here. There are lots of trees coming. This slope is pretty stable. There's little erosion taking place on it. Here, obviously, we've got an unstable slope, very little vegetation remaining. We've got water at the base of it. Here we've got a nice sandy beach in front and some little bit of sand dune there. So there's bits of both in our area. Okay, so that's the end of cohesive bluffs. Is it clear as mud or not?
No, it's not. Thank you very much. There were three consecutive slides that you showed her a minute ago. Cohesive bluff erosion process, and then toe erosion, and then bluff slope erosion.
Mm-hmm.
Those three slides indicated to me that it was too late to plant vegetation.
Okay.
So, mm-hmm. So the question is, are those not good examples where shoreline protection would prevent more erosion at the toe?
The vegetation doesn't prevent anything on the toe. Basically, the vegetation's really protecting the slope. Upper slope, yeah, and so the idea with the vegetation, and this is what Billy Singh did in the report. If you've got a bluff that's not having serious toe erosion, your house is good, as long as what you want to do is to make sure that you don't lose your house, not because of what's happening at the toe, but because you've been such a bad steward that you've cut down all the trees and you've not let the vegetation grow. So you don't want your slope to go back like that. And you want to prevent, you do all those things of making sure that water doesn't come over the top of the bank. You want to divert it around, or you put it into pipes that bring it down to the beach and not allowing it to go down the slope. So the vegetation part of it is really to make sure that you don't have erosion of the bluff slope, and lose your house because of that, rather than from what's happening at the toe. And yes, you're right. If it's unstable and you've got toe erosion and your slope is, 2 to 1 or 1.5 to 1, it's too late for vegetation at that point. That's not a thing. So that's where you've got two options: leave it as it is and move, or put in shore protection.
Thank you.
If
you install shore protection, it is. It affects your neighbors, right? Because the impact of the waves and how the water moves. So by protecting your land, you may cause erosion.
Yeah, I'm going to do a little bit of climate change, and then we come to that sort of thing. So if you don't mind hauling it, and then we'll deal with it then. Yeah. Climate change, there's sort of general consensus now, I think, among the scientists that it's happening. And what the scientists do is use global climate models to model what the impact of greenhouse gas emissions are. We don't have to go into all those things, but I think the models are now sufficiently good that they make predictions that we can do just reasonably. So the climate change models simulate, so the global climate models simulate atmosphere, the ocean, the surface of the Earth. And they have a grid cell that's about 150 by 300 kilometers. It varies in the particular model. That gives you your general global picture, but it doesn't tell us what's happening or what will happen in the Great Lakes. So you have regional models that take the output from the global model and say, okay, let's look at the Great Lakes or the Arctic or the Gulf of St. Lawrence or something. And here's one. This is in the paper that we did. So this is a model of what's the sort of range of temperature change that we can expect for Chicago. This is what the model said. This is the actual and predicted by the model. And then this is under relatively small amounts of greenhouse gas emissions and relatively large amounts. So it could be, we could go from something around 10.5 degrees Celsius up as high as 16 degrees Celsius, or perhaps only as much as 12 or 13. Those are predictions. I don't really want to get into the controversy over that. I want to say what do we actually see happening now? And this is the actual measured global warming. This is the 0 degrees here is the mean temperature between 1901 and 2000. So it's a 100-year average temperature, and this tells you whether the temperatures were greater or smaller than that. 0.4 degrees Celsius colder, and up here 1 degree warmer. So we see that from about 1900 or so, we've had an increasing temperatures. We've got less cold and warmer, and now we're getting close, about 0.9 degrees Celsius warmer than we were in that average over the 100 years of 1901 to 2000. One of the things we know is that climate fluctuates. And so, you know, we get a bit of a warming here and a little cooling, a bit of warming and so on, but the trend has been upwards, and much of it has happened in the last sort of 25 to 40 years. In the period around 2000 and to 2010, there was a period of time when it looked like the climate wasn't warming any longer. We now know that's a pause, and it reminds us that we always have to look at what's happening over a fairly lengthy period of time, a couple of decades, 30 years. There will always be times when the temperature goes up and the temperature goes down. The same with precipitation. We know that the lake level goes up when we have a lot of rainfall, and it goes down when we don't have a lot of rainfall. So that's what we're seeing now. And measured temperatures, we see what all of the models say is it's going to get warmer globally, but that warming is going to be greatest in the northern hemisphere and in the northern latitudes of the northern hemisphere. So we fall into that. We won't get as warm. Our temperatures won't warm nearly as much as they will in the Arctic. They're warming much more. And what's a little bit problematic is what's happening in Greenland, because Greenland has our second largest ice sheet. A proxy measure of this is also sea level. I happen to do a fair amount on sea level, so I'm interested in it. But sea level is rising, and for the last, since 1993, we've had satellites that measure the global sea level. And when you look at sea level, you can see it's rising, and that's a pretty constant rate of 35 centimeters a century. And it's rising for two reasons. One is that we're melting the glaciers and ice caps. When you have to go to the Columbia. And the second reason it's warming is because when that water comes into the ocean, it gets warmed over time, and the water expands when it warms, so that the total increase in sea level is a function of more water and warmer water. So when I see these sorts of things, I say, okay, I'm going to believe them for the moment. And I think it was quite neat this summer that we had the juxtaposition of the finding of the second ship from the Franklin expedition. And that's the wheel on middle of August. And then at the end of August, we have the Crystal Serenity. I'm sure you all saw it sailing from west to east through the... there's no doubt that the sea ice is receding in the Arctic, and that's another expression of global warming. The key for us here, I think, is that that same thing is happening in the Great Lakes. And if you measure ice cover in the Great Lakes, we see that over time, all those fluctuations are in there. But over time, when we put an average on it, the ice cover is decreasing. And it's not so much that in any one year we don't get a large extent of ice, but what's happening in particular is that the duration of ice is going down. And and the predictions are that this will continue. We had our last really big ice year in 2014, and this is dark color means lots of ice. Since then, they've gone way down, and this is the ice cover in 2016. It is February 21st in both years, and you can see it's pretty well ice-free in Lake Huron. That was true again this year. Most of the ice, we got ice for a bit in March. The key thing here is that waves form on open water. When the ice comes, it shuts down the wave system. But if we reduce that duration of having ice present, when the big winds blow in late December, January, February, they produce big waves out on the lake. This year, we can see this from from the Goderich storm. This is March in Goderich. And these are wave setups due to storm events. And the set down is when we've got easterly winds blowing offshore, so the water level actually goes down. So this is open water, essentially. We had at least three storms, and I think where their forecast wave heights on Lake Huron were 5 meters or greater. It's a big wave. And that's what we have to expect, because the winter, late fall and early winter in particular, when the big waves come, that has an impact on our processes. So the takeaway from this is that the increase in the number of storms that we get in a year, and probably in the intensity, because those are the bigger storms, is going to increase wave erosion at the toe of the bluff and also underwater. So when we're looking at the management plan, we have to say, okay, we're basing that plan on existing measurements, but we need to keep in mind that those rates of erosion may go up, and they may go up 20, 30, maybe even 40%. And I don't know the number. Okay? I don't think anybody does. I meant to just go back one. There is also one of the other things will be that with the warmer temperatures, we have more rainfall in the winter months than snow. And rainfall, of course, at a time when there's no leaves on the bushes and the trees, means that slope portion may be subjected to more recession. It's all doom and gloom, isn't it? Not all like that. Okay. I want to just come back. Sorry, let me stop there. Questions about the climate change part of it? Okay, all right. Well, that's good. All right. So let's look at the shore protection part, and this is where we come back to the whole question of what happens. When you're designing shore protection in the Great Lakes, you have to take into account those seasonal and long-term lake level fluctuations. Just as in the marine environment, you have to take into account the tidal rise and fall and so on. And we can see here that we have very high, this is our last high water period going back to about 1985, 86. Another one in here, but not as bad. And then we had this 15-year period with relatively low lake levels the whole time. And that's why I said things were happening underwater, although everybody was having a good time on the sandy beaches. And then we had this record low in October 2013, I think it was. And then this very rapid rise, almost a meter of rise in lake level, which, you know, started chopping back on people, the grasses that had grown down on the beach, and brought waves right up to the toe of the bluff again. You've got, this is 2014, the water's just coming up, but in this location, because the recession is quite rapid, we've got water at the toe of the bluff. You can see even on very low wave conditions, This is the silt that's been eroded, and it's going to disperse offshore. And we've got some disruption on the slopes itself. So these slopes are now, you can't stop it with vegetation at this point. Notice this structure here. And so if we go to 2016, that structure is gone, you know, so we've got all these other structures in place here. And these, let me zoom in on that a bit. Okay. One of the problems that we have with the private shore protection is that it's constructed by individuals all the way along the coast at different times with different contractors. Most of them are not done by a qualified coastal engineer. And so you've got this hodgepodge of stuff here. The shield pile here with some little things in front of it there. People still want to get access to it. This is low wave conditions again, and yet the water's up there. So when you have this situation, you don't have a beach any longer. And that's one of the amenity values. And if you look at anywhere, the shoreline, you've got everybody's got their steps going down to the beach. If you're on an eroding shore and you put this in, then the beach is gone ultimately. That's one of the concerns. I don't know whether the presence of this structure here had any impact on what happened here. It could well have. There is a downdrift impact. I know now that it is having an impact because any sand that's moving offshore here comes ashore down this part, and so there's no sand coming ashore in that location. These are all issues that we have to think about. So what do we do about shore protection going forward? And I say we, but it's actually you, not me. I want to just show you, just finish before we can discuss that. I started working on the cohesive shoreline around Grimsby and Stony Creek. We do both the underwater erosion, but also I had a student who was then working with Environment Canada at the CCIW in Burlington. And she did a study, and this is well before the days of GIS, so I mean, she mapped shore protection structures beginning with, in 1934, there were aerial photographs there, 1950, 54, 65, 72, 74, 79. She mapped each structure, and this is just one portion of it, so there were four sheets like this. Every structure was identified, and whether it was still present the next year, the next thing, and whether it was in good condition or damaged. And she surveyed shore property owners to see how long they'd lived there, what their experience was with these. And so I haven't seen anybody else do this yet. But what I found important here was that this is a time from the initial point at which we see a thing. And this is the percent that are remaining in good condition after a period of time. And sometimes when we see them, they're actually damaged. So percent remaining in good condition and percent remaining in good condition, and the blue is percent in remaining good or damaged condition. And so that after 25 years, only about 10% of the structures were still in good condition, which meant, only about 15% were still around. So 85% of the structures that were built were destroyed within 25 years. So you talk to people there, and we talked to a number of the people, and say, why do you keep doing this? What does it cost you to do this? And are you aware of this? And are you aware that what you pay for is what you get? If you buy something that's cheap, it doesn't last very long. It takes a lot to do it. Second thing that colors my views, if you like, on this is I was working on Long Point on Lake Erie in 1985. I just started working there. That was when we had the high lake levels. There was a big storm on December 2nd, 1985. And we had been working at along the thing, but this is Hastings Drive there. Originally, there were about 120 cottages along here on the dunes. By 1985, there were, I think, 105 left. We met with a group of cottage owners from the Long Point Ratepayers Association, myself and Reed Kreutzweiser in my department, in October of 2015, because they were concerned. Lake levels were high and they were worried about houses going. Among the people, there were eight or nine of them, was a person who had his house on Hastings Drive here. And I said, you know, I don't think you can do anything. I would move my stuff out of there. Well, the storm came, and I went down there 2 days after, saw my grad student to do survey all the stuff we did, and we went into Hastings Drive. We had to convince the OPP who were there to stop looting that I was a reasonable person. I've got an honest-looking face, so it was okay. Who should I meet coming out? The same guy. He had a television set in his hand. That's all he was able to salvage from his house. 86 cottages out of the 110 were destroyed in that one night. And and almost all of them had some form of shore protection. So what it made me feel was, I wish that I could have spoken to you 5 years ago, 10 years ago, or something like that. It's no good coming to me, you know, when your house is about to fall into the lake. Ask for advice. Go to the conservation authority. Ask for advice. Before you buy your house, before you buy your dream house. And I don't do very much, but every now and again, somebody emails me and says, can you come and tell me what I should do about my erosion? And I do it. It's what I call my advising. I go and I do it, you know, happy to come and talk to you. No need to pay me and I'll give you some advice. But I wish they would do that before they buy the property and not after. So these sort of numbers and my experience colors a little bit of what I think. This is what works. This is actually at the same site I've measured underwater erosion. Rogers Cable TV put in a huge set of antennas on the lake. If you come from between Hamilton and Grimsby, you'll see them. And they put in this shore protection. Even then, it was something like $1 million a kilometer. It's still there, though, and it's not in bad shape. You can see some of the boulders at the front are beginning to move down into the lake a little bit. But it's got it'll do 50 years without any problem. For the rest, if you have relatively high erosion rates on ABCA, I would bet this is the only thing that's actually going to stop it. And so if you're going to allow shore protection, you have to assume that people will ultimately go for this because the other stuff doesn't last long enough. So I'm happy to, you know, to discuss anything I've said and also to discuss anything about the shore protection.
Well, the obvious question here is, who are the property owners to the east of the water line from here?
Oh, yeah, Rogers, who have lots of money to put it in.
But
yeah,
they're not cottage owners.
No. And that's part of the problem is that, you know, as I said, if you're a property owner with, I don't know, what's the standard sort of thing? Is it 100 feet, something like that? And you want to put in shore protection, and you say, gosh, I want to make sure that it's well designed, and I want it to last 50 years, 25 years. I mean, the CA won't even really look at it. If it doesn't last at least 25 years, there's no point looking at it. So you want to hire a coastal engineering company to do it, and there are many people who will do it, Shore Plan and Beard and so on. But it costs a fair chunk to hire somebody to do it, and then you've got to go through all those processes, you've got to take it to the CA and say, does it meet specs and all that sort of thing. And now, if you do that, you've got to show that there's no adverse environmental effects, so that when you put in your thing, that the person down there doesn't, person downdrift isn't going to be adversely affected. And so you have to, your coastal engineer will put in all that stuff and decide on it. But it's those are the things you have to do. That's a lot of money.
Well, just to follow up, but the grandkids wouldn't be safe. There.
No, the grandkids. It depends a
little bit on what the underwater rate is, and actually, there is a report done by Baird and Associates in 1990, right, on shore protection. You've hired them to do an update of that. But back then, they have the whole thing. They've actually even got graphs in there that show what the underwater rate is, and therefore how you have to design that tow and how far out you have to go to make it last 100 years. Ultimately, you know, if you're protecting the, I don't know, Bruce nuclear power or something, you can build it big enough, but the longer you want to protect it, the bigger you have to build it.
Something like this is great for an area like Lord said, where there's no cottages, because what you're doing there is you're just basically protecting the land.
Yes, behind it.
Behind,
yeah.
That's all you're doing.
And you have
no beach after that.
And it's you know, I mean, I go along here and I've done, the nice thing is that Jeff flies the shoreline every, it's a wonderful way of doing things. All the work I've done, you just go up in a plane and do it, because you can look then over time at what's happening. But when you look at the shoreline, you're so impressed by how every single cottage has its, you know, however it's constructed, steps going down to the beach, you know, and they all want to put a little place to keep a canoe or a kayak or a sunfish or whatever are down there. So ultimately, if you put this in along the whole shoreline, you've lost that amenity. But it's a decision, let's say, you guys make the decision, I just make the suggestion.
You look at, do you want to keep your cottage in your view on the land that it is,
yeah,
or do you want to keep the beach?
Yeah, and that's a toss-up. But if you look at the Long Point experience on Hastings Drive, there's still maybe 10 people living there. They live in a fortress. They've got stuff above level. There's one person I went to see last year who asked me to come I said, she has no beach. Basically, her wall ends in the water. And if you go down, a kilometer down the beach, you're into the where all the cottages, beautiful sandy beaches, you know, sand dunes and that. But where they are, it's just gone back too far. There's nothing. So.
See, you mentioned affordability, and it's one thing we'll have to grapple with, and the variation in the recession rates that we have within,
yeah,
our watershed is big, and then you have these requests that we would like to know, is this properly engineered, and the people will bring a contractor that's been doing it for a long time without any scientific basis, and he spoke in here and says, you know, we know this works, and we've been doing this for,
yeah,
these 16 years, it's all good. So I think the big task in this whole, and that's I think why shoreline protection is at the forefront, and also the timeline is to find,
yeah,
a solution.
What what I think you will find is that the, if you're using sheet pile, it works in areas where the recession rate is low, because if it's 10 or 15 centimeters a year, the downcutting is not sufficient to affect its structural stability for 15, 20, 25 years. And if it lasts 25 years, I mean, you know, you're probably getting a different contract. The thing is that if you get the coastal engineer to do it, that coastal engineer has to say what the design life is and has to build to that design life. And if it isn't built to the design life, somebody takes it to the engineering thing and brings a suit against you. And you can even, you know, you can have your license removed from you. So they have to put that time in. So if Baird and Associates or Shoreplan or whatever builds you a wall, you know that you've got some fallback on it. And you'll get from them a design lifespan. But if somebody comes in and puts in some blocks and, you know, they're building patios one day and a seawall the next, nobody gives you, I mean, you can't say, can you give me a 25-year guarantee? Nobody's going to do that. And you know it's not going to last that long. So those are issues that I think that you have to wrestle with. And then there's the environmental impact too. What's happening now is essentially we're bringing the environment into the shoreline in the same way that it's in the floodplain. And I mean, I'm a physical person, but I work with the fisheries and oceans people on the thing. I work with wetlands people. You know, I work with sand dune people. I'm quite like biologists, not all of them, but most of them. Yeah. And they're right. It is a problem. I mean, you've got migrating birds who use the bluffs. You've got shorebirds who feed and the stuff. And there was ones who are migrating from up north down to the South America. They need to fill up. So if we can preserve some of that for them, I mean, a lot of them will use the big places like Long Point and Point Pelee and so on. But there are birds that walk along. Those are things that, you know, that count as well in the same way that they do along the river system.
I was wondering what the long-term impact has been of that successful shoreline protection on the properties adjacent.
The Downdrift property is 50 Point. And 50 Point, the conservation authority there, Halton, yes, built a marina. And so they've got armor stone all the way, so the thing's more or less connected now. I think the only thing adjacent to this between that was a settling pond for sewage treatment, but I think that's all been removed now because it wasn't going to last too long. But it was an issue.